Hyperion Audio presents 365 Thank Yous. The year a simple act of daily gratitude changed my life. Written and read by John Kralik. Chapter 1. The Lowest Day. On December 22, 2007, I felt my life was at an irreversible personal nadir. My law firm was losing money and losing its lease. I was going through a difficult divorce, was completely out of funds, and was living in a small, stuffy apartment where I often slept on the floor under an ancient air conditioner. My sons had grown distant from me. A horrible year was ending, with promises that things would soon be even worse. I still remember that lowest day. On my way to work that morning, I got a call from my friend Bob, who had gone to law school with me in Michigan 30 years before. Bob asked how I was doing. This was a mistake. Poor Bob. Not good, is what I said, and my tone was desperate and bitter. I no longer had the ability to pretend that everything was fine. Bob asked if I wanted to go to breakfast. Another mistake. Later, he would tell me he had never seen me this upset. That morning, Pasadena was entering its famous seductive New Year's beauty. With businesses and schools closed for the holidays, the smog clears from the mountains, revealing just 4 miles up Lake Avenue from where I stood, the fresh winter brush of the San Gabriel foothills, each ridge a different shade of misty gray in the soft morning light. But I wasn't in those gorgeous foothills. I was meeting Bob at a dingy coffee house near the dust and the vagrants of Pasadena's downtown center. Although the chain restaurant was Bob's choice, I couldn't afford to eat any place nicer. I couldn't even afford to eat at this place. The man Bob saw across the chip formica table was 52 years old, 40 pounds overweight, pasty and tired, with a terrified sadness in his eyes. After 28 years of work as a lawyer, I had little more to show than I had had when I started, and the little I did have was in jeopardy. Perhaps because I did not need to be in court that morning and hadn't steeled myself for court, my usual stoicism about my situation had broken down. I was letting my true feelings show. As I explained to Bob, I had worked harder than ever at being a good lawyer in 2007. The results were in. I was a failure. First, a pair of clients for whom I had recovered more than $1 million that year had stopped paying my bills. When I brought this to their attention, one of them started writing me emails with the subject heading, "Your bills," with "bills" in quotation marks. Together they owed me $170,000, which I needed to make my end-of-year payroll and pay Christmas bonuses and maybe have something left over for myself. Although they could not agree on much else, these clients decided to work together on a plan that could eliminate their attorney's fees. They jointly ordered the money I had recovered transferred to Texas, where I could not lean it to pay my bills. Then there was the case of the sweet woman who had asked me to sue a gentleman she believed was helping her brother hide money from her. After my client gave up the case, it became apparent she'd had a brief affair with the defendant before suing him. Something about the way the affair ended, combined with getting sued, left this defendant unsatisfied with a mere dismissal. So he sued me for having taken on her case against him. When I sat down to breakfast with Bob, I had just paid a retainer to the lawyers who would defend me and had begun the process of going through every document, every email, and every pleading in the case to formulate my defense. The suit against me was a plain example of how legal proceedings can become a circle of hatred in which each vicious legal move is countered by an even more malevolent one until everyone is out of money. In my darkest moments, I worried that my client's ex-suitor and his relentless desire for revenge would not only leave me completely out of money, but would call my practice into question, effectively ending my career as a lawyer. 7 years before, I'd started my small law practice idealistically. Like some wannabe legal Jerry Maguire, I had set forth my ideals in a mission statement. The statement of ideals, which I shared with my associates and even posted on the wall and on my website. For example, I promised to be true to our beliefs in right and wrong, both as lawyers and as human beings. I signed clients up at low rates, commemorated in simple one-page retainer agreements, because I wanted to avoid the page after page of legal mumbo-jumbo that most lawyers use to cover their backsides. My rates were low because I worried about the effect of my bills on my clients. I wanted to do no harm, which my father, a surgeon, had always preached to me as the foundation of his ethics. Unlike a doctor's, a lawyer's treatment does often, in Hippocrates' words, injure or wrong a client. I wanted to help people before my bill became their biggest problem, and I became the principal person harming them. But during 2007, I learned, in a painful way, that such idealism had serious limitations as a business model. I tried to be logical about what would happen next. It seemed insane to keep trying to do what I'd been doing, but I could not see a way out with all my clients and my employees depending on my willingness to proceed. I had counted on the clients who owed me the $170,000, and I felt too embarrassed to tell my employees now, just 3 days before Christmas, that there would be no money for year-end bonuses. Bob wondered why I was even thinking of bonuses. Why, with all my other problems, was it even on my mind? Throughout the year, we'd been trying to renew the lease in our office space, but then the building went up for sale, and for months we had no landlord from whom to seek a new lease. Then, at the beginning of December, a new owner bought the building, and his first decision was to end our tenancy, unless we wanted to accept an above-market rent. When we balked, he asked us to leave as soon as possible. We now needed about $25,000 in cash if we wanted to sign a lease for comparable space in another building. When you run a small law practice, much of what comes in also goes out to rent, employees, insurance, and the other expenses of running the business. What's left at the end is your salary, so to speak. For me, for 2007, this salary was going to be nothing. In fact, it was less than nothing. I had lost $12,652. Clients had failed to pay nearly $400,000 in bills. One client paid in toys, worth an eighth of his bill, and he was one of the good ones. My last vacation had been in 2003. I had worked 60 hours a week all year without a break, for less than nothing, it turned out. I had accomplished a tour de force of failure. Aside from producing no measurable compensation, my work and my role in the world that it represented had become detestable to me. I'd wanted to help people as an attorney, but too often I was still just the vehicle whereby clients conveyed hatred, sought retribution, and inflicted pain on their fellow men and women. Some lawyers love the fight and never weary of it. I was not one of those lawyers. To me, the work was too often best done when I got in touch with my inner evil core, and I didn't want to be in better touch with my inner evil core. My personal life provided no respite from the seeming financial failure of my practice. 4 years before, my perhaps too relentless pursuit of law practice ideals had helped cause a separation from my second wife. After the separation, she'd remained in our house, and I had moved into one of the nicer new apartments in town. Now that my money was running out, I was living in a small, cheap, poorly ventilated apartment that became an intolerable oven in the summer and cost hundreds of extra dollars in the winter because of inefficient electric heaters. Several nights each week, my 7-year-old daughter lived with me in this plaster box. In the summer, she and I slept on a plastic inflatable mattress in the living room, under the loud, aging air conditioner, which provided a small pocket of coolness as long as we lay on the floor directly underneath it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.